seen the text from him this week. As I was trying to read it, it kept popping in. It ended up in 11. You know, the show was 11, but I got to read what he was saying. And he was saying how he wants to just stand for God. And how, you know, he knows that the enemy was trying to attack him. Just wanted to keep him encouraged and let him know that let God make room for your gifts. And realize that the enemy's job is to come to steal, kill, and destroy. Amen. And to take the things that God has for you away from you. Amen. This is the man that truly loves God, that he's walking in his calling. And one thing we have to realize that as a young man, he's still out there with peer pressure. He's still out there in high school where everybody's telling him, you don't take all that. And you got to do all that. And you need to be having your fun right now. All that can come later. But I want to encourage you, keep on driving on, keep on using your gift that God has given you. Amen. To the best of your ability. Amen. True men that truly love God, amen, and he's standing, amen. We want to continue to encourage him. Amen. Encourage him to keep on driving on and keep on pushing on, amen. Our speaker for today, amen, is our youth pastor, Brother Jawon. Put your hands together.
Of your people. And Lord, I pray that the mind is guarded by your word in the name of Jesus. And everything that's causing the mind of your people to be distracted, God, I pray right now in the name of Jesus that you allow them to hear the word and the word only. In the name of Jesus, I'm coming against every demonic force, every demonic spirit, every burden, everything that they came to get in the name of Jesus, God. I'm praying right now. In the name of Jesus, God, that we have no way. In the name of Jesus, God, I'm praying that they don't come. They'll leave out the same way that they came. In the name of Jesus, God. And I'm praying these things in Jesus' name. Every stress, all kinds of problems that you came in here with. God, I'm praying right now that you release them. And to be able to understand the word, hear the word, God, you said in your word, God, and them that let them have a ear, let them hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. And I pray right now in the name of Jesus, and I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Come on, somebody clap your hands for Jesus.
Welcomed him,
for they were all waiting for him. And behold, there came a man named Jairus, and he was a ruler of the synagogue. Fell down at Jesus' feet and begged him to come to his house. For he had only a daughter about 12 years of age, and she was dying. But as he went, the multitude thronged him. A woman having a flow of blood for 12 years, who had spent all of her livelihood on physicians who could not heal, that could not be healed by any of them. None of the physicians that she spent her livelihood or her money on, none of those physicians was able to help her. This 12-year-old girl was going through a problem from birth, because she was, the Bible said that his daughter was 12 years old, and she's been going through this problem for 12 years. So she was going through this her whole life. And she was losing blood. She was losing blood. The Bible says there was a flow of blood, but she was losing blood for 12 years. This is a problem that she's having here. Glory to God. And the Bible also says that Jairus was a ruler of the synagogue. Amen. Thus God, even him as being a preacher, knew who to go to seek for help at a time like this. God began to give me this revelation. And the question ran by why many people are not doing well spiritually. I don't know why God's bringing me this way, but I'm just going to follow God. He's going to tell me, he said, because simply we don't live where we ought to. Meaning that sometimes we live in other people's business. We tend to be in other people's business more than we attend to our own. Yes. And we're always worried about what Sally Sue's doing and what Billy Bob is doing and you know, what they're doing at their house and what they're doing when they're not at church. And you know, we're always in their business. So we don't live where we ought to live to get the blessing that God has for us. And he also said we have homesteaded and we are in the state of confusion. In the county of complaint, in the city of do nothing, in the block called critical, at the far end of Kent Street. I'm going to say that again. We have homesteaded in the state of confusion. Our mind is completely blinded. The Bible says the gospel be hidden into them that are lost, the hopes of God's world have blinded the minds that don't believe. In the county of complaint, constantly complaining. You're never satisfied with nothing. God blesses you, and even though that God blesses you, you still have something that you want to complain about. Even though you ask God to bless you to pay your bills, because God bless you to pay your bills, but you need gas money, you're not satisfied. We're in the county of and we're in the city of do nothing. And I say the city of do nothing because not only us, but there's people around us that we surround ourselves with that just simply do nothing. Lord have mercy. Look at your neighbor and say, we're in the city of do nothing. In this city here, we just can't move. We can't move forward or backward at all. Because you're not putting no effort at all. And in this time here, we always in the state of mind that we feel that God has to give me. I don't want to pray and I don't want to fast and I don't want to study your word, but I need you to give me.
Yes.
The problem is that God began to show me is that a lot of people know the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, yes, and can quote it from, yes, Genesis to Revelation. Yes. But the thing is about this, is that if you can read the word from Genesis to Revelation, yes, the question is, can you comprehend Genesis, yes, to Revelation? And the question is still being pondered on, because we have a lot of people that can quote it, but they cannot understand it.
Yes. Yes.
Amen. And then we in the block called critical. We in the block called critical. We have made ourselves gifted and special expert critics. We are so quick to be so critical to people.
Yes, Jesus. Yes, yes, we are.
Nah,
yes, we are.
Come to the
point. Yes, yes.
We're so critical at times.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. And at these times here, we wonder why sometimes people come to us,
yes,
and be critical.
Come on.
Boy, have mercy. I feel it coming. Jesus, have mercy. And we at the far end of cancer.
Yes.
Before we try anything, we just say, I just can't do it. We don't even put no effort into it. We just say, I just can't do it. Because the obstacle might be too tall for you. I can't do it. Oh, Jesus, have mercy. David fights a giant that was larger than him. And even though he was larger than him, David fought him and won. He didn't say, I can't do it, because he's bigger than me. I often hear people say that size does not matter. And you fighting somebody, size don't matter. They say the bigger you are, the harder you fall. Come on, somebody. Need a little help here. But the part that I did not mention, even though we're at the far end of Kent Street, we're in the house of doubt. We're so quick to doubt everything.
Yes.
We don't believe everything that we hear. We don't, unless we see. You can say that right now, at this time, that it's not raining outside. But unless I go outside and realize that there's no water dropping on me, I won't believe until I see it.
Yes.
So we're in the house of doubt because we are slow to believe the truth, but so quick. Oh my God. And we're so quick to believe a lie.
Amen.
We have these people on CNN News and saying that all these scientists have predicted that on 12/21/12 that the end of the world is here. Oh. And you have a lot of people that are believing these things. And us being Christian people, some of us are still in the, it's like we're in the middle of the seesaw, because we don't know exactly which way to go. Oh, God have mercy. People, the thing is that even us as Christians, the Bible says no man knows, but still, we still ponder about it. And you don't tell somebody you ponder about it, but you still ponder about it. The thing is about scientists, they only go by tests that they go out there and they go test a thing and they set up hypotheses. The whole scientific method thing. And they find out, and then unless it's proven, it's true. It's a fact. Unless it's proven, it's a fact. If it's not proven, it's just still a question. It's still a hypothesis. It's still a question. And the question has not been answered. So that means that even scientists are wrong. And then even with these things going on, God began to break into here. He said, but we need to learn to move,
yes,
to the state of joy.
Yes.
We need to move to the state of joy.
Yes.
In the county of bliss.
Yes.
In the city of love.
Yes.
In the block of hope.
Yes.
On busy street,
yes,
which dead end into Glory Avenue. In the house of true faith. Switch me as I'm sitting here, so I'm just going to follow God.
Amen.
But the message today would be, show me Jesus.
Yes.
Show me Jesus. The scripture sitting here says that Jawon had a daughter that was had an issue of blood flowing for 12 years of her life. And by her being 12 years old, it proves to us that she's been going through this for a long time. And it also talks about how she has spent her money on physicians,
yes,
on scientists, on people who thought they knew, on people who said that, well, you know, it's scientific proof. If you take this Tylenol, your headache is gone. But did not result to the main source. This young girl here, the Bible also declares that she makes it up in her mind that if she gets to Jesus, that she is going to be made whole. She's going to be healed. And even though that she made this, she didn't just say this. She wasn't just in the city of do nothing. She made it an action.
Yes.
Oh God, have mercy. I'm trying to preach this thing. But she presses through the crowd. She presses through the crowd. She sees that Jesus, the healer, is in the crowd. He's in the crowd. And she presses her way through the crowd. And the Bible says that once she touched the hem of his garment, the flow of blood stopped. Now the question is, how did the blood stop? How did the blood stop? Because she came in contact with the healer. She came in contact with Jehovah.
Amen.
She didn't come in contact with Dr. Johnson.
Come on, baby.
And she didn't come in contact with physical therapist Jones. She came in contact with the hair doctor.
Amen.
Oh, God. She came in contact with the healer. Not a healer, but the healer. And this healer didn't need to write a prescription. Because the very power that was on the inside of him, he already knew of. The spirit and the anointing on the inside is the medicine that she needed. But though she spent her money on physicians trying to help her and make her run this and go do that, go drink this and go eat that. And the thing is that even though she spent her money, the Bible says physician, so that means that it was just not just one doctor, but she went from doctor to doctor to doctor to doctor trying to find out where is the medicine. So then she becomes to the point to where she comes to the point to where she says that these physicians don't have what I need.
Right.
God have mercy. So what is it that I need? Because this Tylenol is not working. And the saline is not working. The Advil is not working. These medicines are not working. So what can stop the flow of blood? Most of us have a proclivity of believing that if we take medicine, that the healing is automatically and immediately going to stop the problem. Oh, God have mercy. I got to tell you this testimony. I was at work yesterday. And what happened was I felt a tightness in my stomach. I wondered what was going on. I said, God, I said, man, this pain is just, and it was like it was getting stronger and stronger and stronger. And I said, okay, God, I haven't ate anything. And I said, well, maybe I just need to eat. So once that happened, you know, I went to my truck and, you know, I'm about to try to eat. And God said, well, how about you just suck about 30 more minutes? And I said, okay. I said, all right. So I went back to doing my job and things like that. And it started hurting even more. As I kept on walking, it just kept tightening and tightening and tightening. And I'm like, God, okay, well, I don't know what's going on here. I don't know what the deal is. What, tell me what's going on. And what happens is he told me, he said, lay your hands on your stomach. And as I laid my hands on my stomach, I began to pray. And as I began to pray, I felt there was a pulling in my stomach. There was a pulling. And as I began to continue to pray and pray, and I said, amen. I said, God is done. Not even 5 minutes after that, it was gone. I didn't go to Dr. Greg. I didn't go to no doctor. I went to the healer.
Yes.
I went to the healer.
Yes.
And when you come in contact with the healer, you're able to be healed without question. Though he healed this woman, when she touched him, the Bible says that he felt the power come out of him when she touched him. And he said, who touched me? And Peter said, oh, were you in a crowd, so who is not touching you? And he said, no, it's something that happened when somebody touched me. There's something that will draw out of me when somebody touched me.
Yes.
Oh, I feel it here.
Yes.
God have mercy. So when she touched him, she siphoned the anointing from his cloak. Oh, Jesus have mercy. The things that we have to do to get healed. As she pressed through the crowd, she had a mind that was determined that she was going to do something, and if she done what she had to do, she would be healed. She was going to be set free of this type of thing that was happening to her from birth all the way to now she's 12. She said that there is my message right there. So I have to go out and find out God for Jehovah Rapha. I thank God for Jehovah Nisi. And I thank God for Jawon. Amen. Just God. And I hear this all the time. I'm like, well, Jehovah, okay, so this is just his different name. But after Jehovah sends a message of what it means, glory to God, have mercy. And the thing is this, is that when you are in so much pain, not only in the showing about pain, the thing is when you are so much pain, you are determined to do whatever it takes for it to stop the pain. The thing is that people don't understand what they're doing wrong until they suffer the pain. Okay, so now the thing is that people constantly complain about going through pain and suffering. But the thing is that we pray for so much, but we want to do so little. And God is getting tired of playing pity pat with us. And he's sick and tired of these slothful spirits. Oh, I feel it here. The thing is that people always try to have an excuse of why they are not doing what they have to do to be saved. We have all these people, they say I'll be saved when I get my life right, and I'm going to smoke my last cigarette, and then I'm going to be saved. I'm going to go to God. And when I finish this last liquor bottle, I'm going to be saved when I finish this last drink. But there was a man, his name was Michael Jackson, that said, this is going to be my last show. But after this show, I'm going back to God. So I preach it like I'm filling up his feet.
Amen. Glory to God. He give you this medication, and by him giving this to you, amen,
this water. You take it one time, and then you have to take it again, and then you have to take it again, and take it again. Why? Because it's just temporary. But God is a God that is not temporary. He is not a God that is temporary. Glory to God. But see, that's the thing. That's why I thank God for that song, Pressing Your Presence. Because see, though she was going through, and she was going through pain and suffering, she was suffering. And her, and then on top of that, her daddy was a preacher. So why did the preacher be able to heal her? And why wasn't the preacher able to deliver her? But the Bible says that that preacher fell at Jesus' feet. So the preacher knew who Jesus was. He came in contact with the healer to heal his daughter from the blood of blood. But he was not able to, even though that I'm going through what I'm going through, no matter what happens, if I got a stress attack, if I stress enough, I'm going to continue to try to find help. If I'm an alcoholic and I see that I need help, I'm going to go to rehab. Hopefully they help me. If I smoke cigarettes all my life and I need help, I go to the rehab center, and then what happens is they help me. So you don't look for help until it troubles you. Somebody can catch that revelation. You look for help until it troubles you, until it's convenient for you. When God says that, you know, I'm here and I want to heal you of your problem before you get too deep in. Because this is enough. I'm sick of it. Sometimes we just say, okay, well, God, you know my heart. The Lord knows my heart. No. The thing is, what God showed me even with that, he said, the thing is what the Bible says, that the heart is deceitful. And he said, let this mind be in you that was also in Christ Jesus. You can change your mind. But you can't change your heart. Nobody caught that revelation. You can change your mind, but you cannot change your heart. Because the Bible says only I, not the doctors. The doctor can see the flesh heart. They can go inside of your flesh heart. But only I can actually judge the truth by your heart, not your mind. Because if it was like that, you can just change your heart, you change your mind. When God comes through the clouds, you can begin to worship in your mind and in your heart. But when God brings through the clouds, God has made it to where that when he comes through, you can change your mind from thinking lustful thoughts to believe and start thinking about praises of God, but your heart's still thinking lustful thoughts. I'm stopping there. Amen, glory to God, because see, God taking it pretty deep right now. And the thing is this. Look, I'm not going to stop. The devil's a liar. Oh, Jesus, have mercy. I thank God. Amen. Glory to God. The thing is that if God allowed us to be able to change our minds for what we were thinking about, and then the same thing for our heart, everyone will go to heaven. And the thing is this. You have to think about it like this. How can you try to trick God? When God created you, he created you so that you can change your mind, but never will you be able to change your heart. The way you change your heart is your spirit changing. If you are in the mindset of praise, if you're thinking about God in your mind, then you're thinking about God in your heart. Amen. If you're thinking lustful thoughts of your mind, you're thinking lustful thoughts in your heart. But you can't change this. But you can change this. What people see is what you're thinking. But they don't see. what you believe. They don't see what you believe. God began to tell me, I was preaching again to myself. And God began to tell me that even though scientists have predicted that the world going to end December the 21st of this year, he said that there is going to be of the devil's use to his people. And he said there's going to be a new change in this earth. And he said we're going to be able to move on a new surface, and we're going to move to a new millennium in God. A new power and a new deliverance. A new anointing is coming. He said, new anointing is coming. And he said, it's a new power that not to hit this earth like no before. He said, the devil had his chance. He had it. He said, he had his chance. But now, it's my turn. I've given him his time. Now I'm about to have my time. He said, I'm about to have my time now. Don't be weary in well-doing. For a new season, you shall be free if you faint not. Glory to God. Amen. Let's go. If you don't mind, amen. Let's go. That's the, I'm going to end it right there, but if you don't mind, I must thank God for his, for him using me, I must say. Yes. I thank God for using me because even though, like I said, though I preached that word to you, I preached it to me. And to some preachers and leaders, to learn to do that themselves. Because sometimes leaders know how to exalt themselves. And they'll exalt themselves higher and higher and higher. And then what happens is the leader becomes their God. And it's funny, but your spirits get angry, get frustrated, but it's all right. Because the devil was alive, so was his mother-in-law. To learn how to humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. And he will exalt you. He will exalt you. Amen. 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 Let's give God a praise.
There's a shield of the shield.
Spirit. God, my God.